First prelude is number 506. Our next prelude is number 470.
Good morning, everyone. Our readings for today's Mass are on page 1018, 1018, if you'd like to use a ribbon to mark that page. I know we all at some point struggle with distractions during Mass, so sometimes it's helpful just to have the reading there, just to be able to focus on it a little bit more. Our opening hymn is number 451. Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And
give thanks to our Lord that he has called us to be here this morning. He's allowed us to gather. Give him thanks for the great gift of his words and of the Eucharist. For the times that our hearts have been closed, for the times we've allowed ourselves to become cold to God's work, we now ask him for his mercy. I confess to Almighty God
and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fall. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
us pray. Almighty ever-living God, direct our actions according to your good pleasure, that in the name of your beloved Son, we may abound in good works. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jonah. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, saying, "Set out for the great city of Nineveh and announce to it the message that I will tell you." So Jonah made ready and went to Nineveh according to the Lord's bidding. Now Nineveh was an enormously large city. It took 3 days to go through it. Jonah began his journey through the city and had gone but a single day's walk, announcing, 40 days more and Nineveh shall be destroyed." When the people of Nineveh believed God, they proclaimed a fast, and all of them, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw their actions, how they turned from their evil way, he repented of the evil that he had threatened to do to them. He did not carry it out. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. I tell you, brothers and sisters, the time is running out. From now on, let those having wives act as not having them, those weeping as not weeping, those rejoicing as not rejoicing, those buying as not owning, those using the world as not using it fully, for the world in its present form is passing away. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. After John had been arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God. This is the time of fulfillment. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. As he passed by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting their nets into the sea. They were fishermen. Jesus said to them, "Come after me, and I will make you fishers of men." Then they abandoned their nets and followed him. He walked along a little farther and saw James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They too were in a boat mending their nets. Then he called them. So they left their father Zebedee in the boat, along with the hired men, and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord. A couple weeks ago, in celebrating my birthday, I decided to celebrate it by actually listening to my doctor, and I started taking my medication. I'm at that age. That's how you celebrate your birthday. And I've been fighting it for a year. It's just blood pressure. And as I start taking it, I decided to read the piece of paper that the pharmacist gives you for it. And on the back side, you know, has a font of like 1, and it lists all the side effects. And there was like 500 of them or something. And I reached like the 5th or 6th one, and it's like, you know, I think I'll just risk it with my illness. There's those moments, you know, when you're like, I don't think I want to do this, but still doing it. So this was a particularly great birthday, too, because I also got glasses. Now, they're not invisible. I'm not wearing them, because me and the glasses are having a disagreement right now. I've never had glasses before, and they're the progressive. And I decided the first time I actually put them on was when I was driving, and it was just like, this is just not right. There's something wrong with me, with my brain. I don't know. So it's taking me a little while to get used to them. But as I got out of my vehicle, this is the first time I had them on, I almost fell down because my feet were about 5 feet farther away from my body than they've ever been. Just the way the glass is. So there was a point where I thought, I'm not doing this. I'd rather be blind. So we all have moments where we don't want to accept the change, right? And I'm not talking about change for the sake of change. You know, sometimes I think we do that. Sometimes people will just change the furniture in their house just because they're bored. You know, that's not what this is about. This is where God steps in and says, it's time. It's time to make a particular change in our life. And it's being able to listen to that with clarity. Moms and dads, you kind of know what this feels like sometimes. Because I know all our families, we've done it. Now, in all our families, we all have a particular culture in our family, right? I notice this when I go bless people's homes. Some families, they want you to take your shoes off when you walk in. Other families, they don't care. Every house has like rules or a culture. But we all know that when life throws curveballs at us, sometimes we allow our kids, they start staying up later, and we just kind of let it go, right? We don't pay attention to our diet as well as a family. We just kind of let things go for a while. But there's the moment where it's like, mom says, we need to get back on track. We need to get the kids to bed earlier, right? And so those moments where it's like, okay, there's going to be a change, but it's going to be a hard one. Because do the kids want to go to bed early? No. Especially once they've developed a habit of staying up late. It's that kind of a thing. So moments of change where we know it's something good and then being able to follow through with it. We look at the first reading today and you have Jonah. And so Jonah is commanded by God to go through the town of Nineveh and proclaim repentance. And we know the story of Jonah. Jonah bolted in the opposite direction, right? A whale had to bring him back. But he goes through the town of Nineveh, and he's asking them to do the impossible. He's asking for a whole city to repent, a whole city to change. And Jonah doesn't, it's not that he doesn't have faith in the people. He doesn't have faith in God. He doesn't believe God's going to support him in that. So that's why he's trying to run away. Do we have moments like that where it's like, it's not that I don't trust, you know, in a marriage, I don't trust my spouse. I don't believe God's going to work here. And there lies the problem. We'll get to that in a second, right? So Jonah goes through the town, and you know what? They change. They take it on. Was it easy? No. But they said yes. And that's the beauty of today. You have Jesus walking along the seashore, the Sea of Galilee, and he encounters these fishermen, right? And we don't know the full context of the conversation or even of their relationship, but there's a moment. There's a moment when he calls them. And with Peter and Andrew, you have this very particular moment where they drop their nets. And I think that's a great image for us. We can never change the way God wants us to change if we don't drop what we need to drop. We all have nets. We all have something that God's going to ask us to let go of. Now, it may be something bad. It may be a sin. But it could also be something actually really good. But he's saying, now's the time to take your spiritual life, your faith life, your life of charity. Now's the time to take it to that next level. And we're going to be like Joan. It's like, oh, I don't think he's not going to carry me through this, right? We have to confront that. But there's always going to be a net he's going to ask us to abandon, to drop. The next movement, if you will, is James and John. And he walks up to James and John, and it's a little different because in that moment, they're sitting there mending their nets. Now, I want to use that as an image with a different sense of the net. And if you can imagine your soul being kind of like a spiritual net. And our souls have to be mended, just like nets have to be mended for fishermen. It's a part of the job. It's not just something they do because they enjoy it. If they don't mend their nets, they'll stop catching fish. And so our own soul needs to be mended. There needs to be that time where we just sit with Jesus and allow him to work on our souls. Because the soul has a purpose, right? It has a function to it. Sometimes we think of a soul almost like a window, right? Well, I'm going to just spray some Windex on it, make it nice and shiny, nice and clean, kind of like confession, you know, now everything's clean. But the soul has a function, and the function is to hold grace. It's to hold God inside of us. It's to be filled with his love, because it's from there that we move forward, we carry on our mission, we do amazing things with God leading us. And so to keep always mending that net so that it will hold God's grace. You can imagine a moment when Jesus is talking to James and John, and they both look at their dad, Zebedee, because you can imagine them being a little bit younger, and they're still under dad. Dad is the authority at that moment in their family. And Jesus is asking them to leave their father. That's the context of this for James and John. And so you can imagine them looking at their dad. And this test is not necessarily on James and John, it's on dad. Because dad has to let his boys go. He may have dreamed his whole life of having his boys work with him, take over his business, fishing, all those things, the pride of being able to work with your son. And he asks the dad to drop that net and to let his sons go. And he does. It's a beautiful example of trust on the part of Zebedee, as well as James and John. Now, the thing with John, so usually in the scriptures, you know, in more traditional cultures, you always name the oldest boy first. And so they always name James first, which is kind of interesting because John is the one who often gets more attention. John, traditionally, we believed he was a teenager at this time because he would live many years after the time of Jesus. If John had never been called by Jesus, he would have remained a fisherman. Nothing wrong with that. But John, he has the capacity to become one of the greatest mystical theologians we've ever had. You read the Gospel of John, and you just get taken up to heaven. It is amazing how he reflects, how he draws these images of all these things happening in Jesus' life through the gospel. That's who God wanted John to be. He wanted him to go to that next level. There are all kinds of little ways that God wants us, each one of us, even our whole families, to go up to that next level spiritually. It might be something as simple as someone saying, you know, for the last 20 years, I've done the same thing in my daily prayer. God's asking me to go higher. He wants me to take my spiritual life to another level there. It could be that. That would be an example. The other day, on Friday, we do this once a month. We have a group of teenage boys that we get together, and we go down to St. Mary Magdalene in Everett, and we gather with a couple priests, and it's just a monthly thing where these teenagers get a chance just to talk about what it's like for us to be priests, just to discern their own vocation. We're not putting pressure on them. We did hand them application. No, I'm just kidding. We didn't. But it's really, really nice. It really is, where they can just kind of be together as a group of teenage boys and just kind of reflect on their own lives and the vocation of priesthood. So we were, this last Friday we went, and we let them ask any questions they want. And one of them asked, he said, what was your greatest difficulty in entering priesthood, what was the hardest thing for you? And I'm always a little nervous about answering that honestly because I don't want people to misunderstand what I'm saying. But for me, it was 100%, it was giving up marriage. It was the greatest challenge I had to confront for myself. But it wasn't just marriage in general. It was a particular thing about marriage. It was giving up having a soulmate. It was giving up having that one person that when things were bad, you know, you think of tag team wrestling, and you just need someone to be in your corner, that you would have that person. But the draw for me also was I could be that for them. And to give that up was really a challenge for me. I didn't go into it a whole lot. I didn't explain a whole lot of it during that meeting. But as we were driving home, I asked the kids who were with me in my vehicle, I said, do you have any follow-up questions from just what we were talking about? And one of them, he said, Father, how did you know when God was calling you to give up, to make that sacrifice, and to choose the priesthood? How did you know? And you could hear in his voice that he's going through the same thing. It wasn't about a moment, per se. It was about the mending of the net. At this time, I was working, and my lunch hour, I would just slip into a church. When I get home from work, I would have adoration in the middle of the night once a week on Friday nights. It was just that time of mending the net. It wasn't the issue of marriage. There was no issue really there for God. There was the issue of my capacity to love, the way God was calling me to love. There are a lot of men and women here who would go through the same thing, but for their vocation to marriage, right? Whatever their vocation may be. And as that mending of the net would happen, there's that moment, there is the moment, when Jesus says, follow me, and we're ready. It's so powerful. You know, a lot of times I think people, this is just a general reflection for me, but I think people do feel sorry for priests because they make a sacrifice to live a life of celibacy, to not be married. I would say it is a mistake to feel sorry for them. If a priest is not faithful, that's a tragedy. Just like if a dad or a mom is not faithful to their spouse, it's a tragedy. It's horrible. But by and large, moms and dads are faithful. They choose to be faithful because they love. And by and large, the vast majority of priests every single day choose to love their people and are faithful. It's not really about giving up something. It's about our capacity to be able to carry God's love with us in whatever he calls us to do. Sacrifices really do seem so small when we see it that way.
Together we profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things are made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven,
by the Holy Spirit, was incarnate to the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, and has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We have heard the word of God proclaimed to us. He sees our sincere efforts to lead good lives, and once again, we ask him for his help.
That the Church of God will fearlessly call people to repentance and belief in the good news, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That like citizens of Nineveh, people will believe in God and renounce their evil behavior, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That men and women will follow Christ and as missionaries become true fishers of men, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That in this passing world, we will hold on to the eternal truths of the good news of Christ and his church, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have died may enter the kingdom of God, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father, hear the prayers of your people. Do not look on our sinful ways, but show us your gentle mercy. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Your additional music guide, page 1.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
Amen.
Accept our offerings, O Lord, we pray, and in sanctifying them, grant that they may profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For when your children were scattered afar by sin, through the blood of your Son and the power of the Spirit, you gathered them again to yourself, that a people formed as one by the unity of the Trinity, made the body of Christ in the temple of the Holy Spirit, might, to the praise of your manifold wisdom, be manifest as the church. And so, in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus.
Indeed, holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Paul, our Archbishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her husband, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Together we pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of our Lord's peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Body of Christ.
For those of you who are unable to receive the Eucharist at this time, we offer this spiritual communion prayer. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot, at this moment, receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Our communion hymn is in your additional music guide on page 3.
Sure.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that receiving the grace by which you bring us to new life, we may always glory in your gift through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a couple of announcements. We are continuing to advertise our women's retreat that is coming up on February 17th. There are some people in the hall, some women in the hall who can answer questions and do, I think, help with registration. So if there's anybody interested. Also, our retreat down to Mount Angel on February 26th through the 28th. There are some folks in the hall who will be doing registration for that as well. I am gone for about 12 days, and so the priest, Father Mitchell, who's filling in for me, he can do everything that I ask him to do except 3 hours of confessions. So he'll do two. He says two is, and then he's got to go to the bathroom. So anyways, so on Wednesday's confession is only 2 hours long. I shouldn't have said that. Please don't tell him I said that. Because when I'm his age, I will be doing the exact same thing. So, all right, I shouldn't have said that either. We do have a little tradition. Not everybody has a habit of doing this, but we like to offer it. If anybody wants to bring their palms back from last year, their blessed palms, we'll have a basket in the back for the next couple weeks. So the tradition is to bring them back, and then we burn them, and then in preparation for Ash Wednesday. So if you like to do that. Also, if you do have blessed palms, normally we never throw them away. We don't just put them in the trash. With any blessed item, we either burn it or we bury it. So those are the ways that we do that. So in the bulletin, we do have financials. Once a month, we do this where we show financials from last week, from last month, and year to date. And we're on the June-July fiscal year, July to June fiscal year. So for those of you who like to see that, it's just us trying to show transparency of our finances, so you can see that once a month in the bulletin. Next Sunday, the prayer shawl ministry will be meeting after the 10 o'clock Mass. Today we do have soup and bread in the hall, and the office will be open. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you all in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass has ended. Let us go in peace.
Number 692, verses 1, 2, and 3.